required. So in the eastern United States, that's not much of an issue. But in the west, there's only a relatively small number of areas that are true dryland farming regions, like the Palouse Hills, for example, where I set my novel Patriots. That's in north central Idaho and adjoining eastern Washington. So the answer to the question in brief is no to lakefront properties, yes to rural residential properties that are in overall agricultural areas.
That's how we have set our stuff up out here. We actually have a running, well, in the winter it's kind of like a small river, but right now it's more like a creek that runs right through our property. And then, of course, we have two wells out here as well on our 10 acres. And we're backed up to about 100 miles, at least east, to BLM land. So we have no neighbors out there. But, you know, we really looked really hard to get this property so that it had its own water supply, that we had the ability to do a lot of hunting. We have a lot of elk here and a lot of deer. And I really thought that we did it more as having a small enough group that we wouldn't deplete our game supply with our hunting. You know, I know a lot of folks have large groups, but we wanted to make sure that we wouldn't deplete our game supply. Is that a kind of strategy that you advocate?
That's admirable, but it's really difficult to predict how many people from the big cities are going to end up camped out on BLM land that you'll have no control over. And they don't count on wild game or fish from your creek because chances are, if it's a really bad situation, there's going to be a large number of people that are going to be pressing those resources very hard and depleting the game. And what little game is there is going to be so spooky it'll be way off in the backcountry. So it's great that you planned ahead in terms of your own circumstances. The big question is, what is everybody else going to be doing? So all I can say is stock plenty of food. You may not be able to depend on wild game much at all.
Go ahead, Reggie.
Well, okay. I also wanted to know, how would you really deal with neighbors? I have my own opinions about this, but if you live in the community and you're thinking about reaching out to some neighbors, how do you reach out to them without showing all your cards?
Well, if it's your immediate, your contiguous neighbors, it all depends on whether you have established relationships with them first. If you don't have fairly solid relationships with your neighbors, I'd recommend that you keep a very low profile. And if you see that some of your neighbors are in need, that you would ask your church elders, for example, to contact them, and they'd end up getting food from you, but they wouldn't know who it was coming from.
Okay.
And in terms of working out mutual security arrangements, I think it's advantageous to, if possible, try to develop commonality of self-defense weapons, commonality of communications equipment, and do all that now if you can. And you can do that kind of informally, and you can find out if your neighbors hunt and say, oh, what caliber do you shoot? And find out if they happen to have set walkie-talkies, and if they're FRS or if they're GMRS or if they're MERS band, find out what they're using. And even if you can't get their agreement now, even if they think you're total whack-a-mo, Looney Tune, they may think you're crazy now, but of course, the day after Kiat Waki, they're going to think they're going to have a whole new attitude. And suddenly they're going to want to coordinate with you. And if you have identified some areas of commonality, so much the better.
Okay, now we're talking about Kiat Waki, and of course that's the end of the world as we know it. Some folks have not known what that meant. And when you talk about the Dow going from 10 to 5,000, and Demcad and I kind of touched on this just a little bit right before you came in, that kind of crash, it's gonna. I mean, really, all services are gonna go down. The folks that are used to, basically, that they believe their homes are a human right and the food that they've been receiving is a human right and such. So all that's gonna stop. How do you think that that's going to turn out as far as for different neighborhoods? And what I mean is we're a pretty divided country. And are we going to see divisions along the lines of local city demographics and Mad Max thug type scenario, you think? Or is it going
to
be...
It's really difficult to predict what will happen. A lot of it has to do with whether or not the power grid stays up. If the grid stays up, we may see a situation that's roughly analogous to the Depression of the 1930s, where there's still, city services available. You turned your tap and the water still came on. You flipped your light switch and the power still came on. And I'm hoping that that's what happens in this unfolding depression that we're in right now. The flip side is, what happens if the power grid goes down? And if that happens, all bets are off. Suddenly, if it does, suddenly you're not going to want to live in a city of 5,000 or 10,000 people. It'll be literally too big to be self-sustaining. You're going to want to be in a community of 500 people or less in an agricultural region or out on an isolated retreat. Because with a larger population, the infrastructure will just fall apart. Most people are not set up with well water or spring water. And even those that are on well water, especially in the western United States, are going to be out of water pretty quickly when the power grid goes down, because they're using a typical domestic well pump that runs on 220-volt AC. And, of course, everything that goes along with that you have to consider, such as, toilets are not going to be flushing, so there's going to be a public health crisis in basically any good-sized town. Anything over 500 people, it's not realistic to think that everyone's going to go, dutifully go out with a shovel and dig a 6-foot-deep outhouse latrine hole. I just don't see that happening. I think there's going to be some huge public health problems. There's going to be a huge outpouring of people from the cities who are out of water, especially in the western United States. And even the east, once you get past about 500 people, it really becomes unmanageable, especially with no radio communications and no phones, to think that you can pull together as a community. Once you lose that sense of community, it's basically every man for himself. I think people will go kind of Mad Max in an absolute worst case with the power grid down. So, and we're really looking at two different distinct situations. And again, in the former situation where the power grid stays up, you might do quite well in a city of 5,000 or 10,000 people. If the power grid goes down, again, I would not recommend being in a town of more than 500 population. And ideally, if you're looking to relocate to a town, you should talk to the city waterworks folks and find out the ideal cities to live in are the ones that have gravity-fed water from end to end of the system, where there's not an electric pump anywhere in the system. It's entirely gravity-fed all the way to your tap. That's the ideal situation. But unfortunately, even in the eastern United States, where water is fairly plentiful, less than 5% of the population actually lives in that kind of situation. In the vast majority of cities and towns, water is pumped up to big tanks, and then it's gravity-fed back down. And in the event of a grid-down situation, there's going to be some really big problems within about a week, because once those gravity tanks are dry, all bets are off.
And can I add something about the whole power grid?
Sure, go ahead.
There's also another issue as well. If there's hyperinflation, then you may have a situation where a lot of people will not be able to afford the energy, and a lot of people may simply have their lights and their heat turned off. And if you're in the Midwest, like in a place like Michigan, and you don't have energy, you don't have any heat for your house, that can create some serious problems. And as far as disease, when a lot of people are going to be stunned by this emotionally and psychologically, and they're not going to be thinking about what type of foods they should be eating, their vitamins to keep their immune system up. They're not going to be thinking about using a 5-gallon bucket and some kitty litter for makeshift toilet or anything. So there may be plagues or diseases spreading because of situations like that.
Mm-hmm. I think that's a very good assessment, Reginald. There's definitely going to be a public health crisis, at the very least, if not a situation where the cities become absolutely unlivable very quickly. I'm talking within 2 weeks. Your average urban dweller just doesn't have the gumption to dig their own latrine, to go out and cut firewood. And even if they were to cut firewood, they wouldn't have any place to burn it. A lot of homes don't even have a proper wood stove or even a fireplace. And everyone knows how inefficient the decorative fireplaces they put in American suburban homes are. We're looking at a cascading chain of events that's not very pretty.
We've got a caller that's been trying to call in for, about 5 minutes now. So I've brought them on the line. Caller, you're live on the Watchman.fm with Demcat and James Wesley Rawls. Go ahead, state your name and where you're from and your question. Caller.
Well,
they've called in three times, but apparently I guess they're not equipped to be on the air. So, all right, caller, I guess you'll have to call back in. Your connection isn't working out. So, before I brought the caller in, who couldn't use the, I guess he didn't have a mic, I'm not sure which, but you were talking about conditions as far as sanitation and things like that, pumped in water. One of the things that folks don't think about is the fact that the toilets and things aren't going to work, like Demcat was saying. How quickly, in your opinion, would it get to be a real problem for disease, things like dysentery and cholera and things like that in an area?
Well, part of it is seasonal. I think that if we were to have the onset of a collapse in summertime, we'd see a public health crisis very quickly. If it were to happen midwinter, we'd actually see more people dying of exposure, dying of the cold, than we would dying of disease, especially in the eastern United States and the Northeast. It doesn't take too long a period before, blankets are insufficient. People don't have any alternate source of heat. They'll be freezing to death in large numbers. Then what happens in the next spring when everything thaws out? Then you have a really big public health crisis, because not only are you worried about human waste, you're also worried about thousands upon thousands of unburied bodies. It could be we could be in a situation where we literally could see a 90% die-off in the major metropolitan regions, 90% population loss. And that's just based on loss of the power grid alone, not counting violence of people, as food supplies dwindle, going from house to house, taking what little is left, fighting over the scraps, in effect. So I highly recommend that if any of your listeners have the opportunity, if they're self-employed or if they can find employment or if they're retired, that they move to a lightly populated rural region that's in a food-producing area. In the event of a true worst-case scenario, I refer to it as when the Schumer hits the fan, that's going to be your safest place to be. And there, the population loss will be minimal. There, the only folks that will be dying will probably be a few people that are diabetics and a few people that were already in very poor health. But the majority of the people will get through just fine. But otherwise, in a grid-down collapse that goes on for more than a year, we literally could see a 90% population loss in the big cities and a 50% population loss in the suburbs, and as much as a 30 or 40% loss in non-viable rural areas. I'm talking desert regions or other areas where there's not a lot of agriculture that goes on.
Go ahead, Demcat.
Yeah, well, somebody else asked a question, and they wanted to know about the chains of events. What do you think will be the trigger event? And that's a pretty tough question, because
oh,
who
boy.
Knows?
That's a toughie. Now, there's so many different scenarios, but, you know, if we were just look at the current economic situation, I think that the big trigger will be a repudiation of American Treasury paper by foreign investors. If they say, hey, we're not going to roll over the American Treasury paper anymore, we're going to take our ball and bat and go home, that very well could trigger an economic meltdown, starting with, you know, a collapse in confidence in the United States dollar, and it could very quickly click over into a mass inflation, very quickly followed by major rioting in the major cities, and the whole cascade from there, a lot like how I described in my novel. But there's umpteen other scenarios. You know, there's a plague scenario. There's a global war scenario, nuclear war scenarios. There's so many different things that can go wrong, and any number of different reasons why life as we know it could cease very quickly. So I highly recommend that all of your listeners do everything they can to prepare. And I realize that not everyone is going to have the opportunity to move out to some idealized rural retreat. You know, not everybody lives out, you know, with national forest on two sides of their property and a river running through their property and bottomland. You know, that's a rarity. But even for people that are on a fixed income, whether they're college students or elderly people on Social Security or whatever, and even if you're in a tiny little apartment, there's a lot of things that you can do to get yourself prepared, and they'll leave you in a much better shape than your, at least most of your neighbors. As I pointed out in my blog last week, even if you live in a tiny apartment, you can at least set yourself up to do sprouting, and you can, you know, sprout all sorts of different things, and that'll give you a great source of fiber and wonderful vitamins and minerals. Sprouting is a great way, it's a multiplier effect, just like any other form of agriculture. I highly recommend it.
We actually had Dr. Prepper on, who really went in depth about how you could pretty much live off sprouts in an apartment. And we do have another caller on the line. And so, caller, you're live on thewatchman.fm. Go ahead and state your name, where you're from, and your question.
My name's Lewis. I'm from Washington State.
All right. You have a question for James or Dimcat or myself?
Yeah, for James, what would you say, what can we do with pets? You know, we love our pets, and we want to know what we can do to prepare them for this economic collapse.
Well, I used to have a friend who would joke that, you know, a real survivalist would eat his pets, but no, I don't believe that. In fact, it's important to keep your cats around to control mice, and if you have a dog that's well trained, they can be a good watchdog or guard dog. So it's important to stock up. The type of food that you should practice getting your dog or cat transitioning to is a dry kibble type food, which is fairly low in oil. So they store much longer than the high oil foods in terms of dry food. Canned dog and cat food is kind of problematic because it's quite expensive, and the shelf life is not that great. So I'd recommend that you stock up on a dry kibble-type food. Practice getting your dog or cat transition to that food now. See how well they do. Because for a lot of dogs and cats in particular, it takes a long time where you have to basically wean them off their old food and onto a new food. So you want to have a supply of both so you can make the transition gradual. And in terms of storing that dried food, you use the exact same method I point out in my blog and in my book, How to Survive the End of the World as We Know It, and in my preparedness course, which is to use a Mylar liner inside of a 5 or 6 gallon food grade high density polyethylene bucket, an HDPE bucket, the typical bakery buckets like you would get at a delicatessen or at a bakery. They give them away free or for a dollar a piece. That's the type of bucket to use. Use a Mylar liner, throw in a couple of oxygen-absorbing packets, and you'll quadruple the storage life of that pet food.
Okay. Well, thank you very much.
All right, and thank you, caller, for calling in. And the first caller, apparently that was the case. They didn't have a microphone, but they did type me the question. I think you'll like this question. So his question was, he wanted to know why you made such a strong argument against the lawful authorities stopping travelers on the road to demand driver's licenses, but then later in the book, the characters stop travelers on the roads near their retreat and demand to know the contents of their bags and gear.
Their whole mindset, the character's mindset changed in that they didn't realize how bad the situation was going to get. At first they were just thinking in terms of getting to their retreat. But as the situation completely fell apart and there was no law and order whatsoever, and to the point where there are actually cannibals wandering around the countryside, they saw the need to literally, stop everyone that came by their property. They considered everyone that passed through their property to be a threat. And they felt obliged to, and I'm not sure if I would go quite so far. I would probably want to hunker down and disappear, but they felt obliged to basically police their own area. And stop and question and search everyone that came through that was not from the region.
Part
of the reason I included that in the book was for the sake of drama. I don't think things are ever going to get quite that bad in America, but it is conceivable.
Well, that was what I was going to add right there, was that actually did happen in the Ukraine. I mean, it wasn't that roaming bands were running around and grabbing people, but there was quite a few documented cases of when Stalin starved the Ukraine that there was actually some cannibalism that went on. So it's not exactly that far-fetched an idea, is it?
No, it's not. There have been a lot of scientific studies that have shown that people revert to cannibalism within 20 days if in the right circumstances. Look at what happened when that airliner full of soccer players crashed up in the Andes. It was only 15 or 20 days before they started saying, if we eat so-and-so and we don't pay, if we don't know the name of the person we're eating, I guess we could eat him. It's not beyond the realm of a plausibility to think that cannibalism can go on. I think it's unfortunately all too likely. So
amazing. Go ahead, Demcat. I just had to add that last part in there because it was in the question prior.
Yeah, I wanted to know, what should somebody do with the rats? I'm going to go old school on you. I'm going to mention the Black Plague, and basically, we know that when there's a lot of dead bodies, rats can start feeding.
Rats will multiply very quickly. Cats, larger cats will take care of rats, as will a lot of dogs of the terrier family. Everything from a really small terrier, like a Jack Russell Terrier, all the way up to the biggest terriers, which is the Airedale Terrier. They'll all catch and kill rats.
But
then you got to worry about, you also got to worry about flea control for your dog. So got to stock up on those kind of supplies as well. But that's all the best that we can hope for is that in the short term, probably the rat population will go way up, but then it'll crash as they run out of food supplies. And you just don't want to be in a really densely populated region, because there you're going to be shoulder to shoulder with rats. They'll be running all over the place. If you're out in the countryside, it really won't be an issue.
Well, it's interesting that you mentioned the rat population exploding and then crashing, because when you look at the human population, historically, it's been pretty flat, except for recently, when it's been exploding.
Yes, it's an upright spike. If you look at it in the long-term scale, if you go all the way back to biblical times, all the way to the modern era, and you plot that in a graph, it would look like an upright spike. I think that some sort of die-off is very likely, and it won't take a lot to trigger it, because we essentially are overpopulated, especially in some regions like Western Europe and North America. we have these huge population centers, and if we were to be reduced to 19th century technology overnight, there's just no way that our nation could support 350 million people. It's just not going to happen. It can't happen. I mean, even if you're just to take modern petrochemical based fertilizers out of the equation, that would be just by itself would be enough to crash our population. We could not feed a population, the population of this country, for more than a few months without the fertilizers. All we'd have is basically one growing season, and after that there would have to be a crash of some sort.
Yeah, I agree. And I know you mentioned going back to biblical times, and this is probably not a question that Demcad would have asked, but as a Christian myself, I read Revelations, and it talks about famines, and it talks about, in no uncertain terms, that we are going to be coming to a Teotihuacan situation. I mean, it's of a magnitude that no one had ever dreamed of. Is that part of why you put up survivalblog.com?
Oh, yeah.
And yes, if you could explain that a little
is.
Bit.
Yeah, I'm a Christian, and I feel very strongly that we could see a tribulation before Christ's return. And I think that it's incumbent upon us, it's our Christian duty to provide for our families. And I go all the way back to the Old Testament philosophy of tzedakah, which is the traditional Jewish system of tithing, which starts with your immediate family, and it goes out in concentric rings to your immediate neighbors, to your neighborhood, to your community, your city, your county, and then depending on your resources, you know, if you were a multimillionaire, conceivably you could provide for a lot more, all the way up to a whole county. But it's important that people stock up in depth. It's important that people keep a perspective of realizing that perilous times can come upon us, and whether it's the end times as foretold in the Bible, or whether it's just a short-term hiccup. Regardless, it's our duty to be well prepared, to provide as best we can for our families, and not shirk our responsibilities. I always think in terms of can you go to bed at night and go say your prayers with your kids and turn off the lights and go to bed knowing that you've done the best you can to provide for your kids no matter what happens. That's the bottom line. I don't want to have a situation someday where I have to stare at my kids across the table and they're saying, "Daddy, I'm hungry." That's the last situation I want to be in.
Oh, I agree. I tell folks all the time, one of my favorite lines is that my kid's not going to look up at me and say, "Daddy, if you knew I was going to be a slave when I grew up, why didn't you do something?"
That's the corollary, yeah.
Yeah, it's the reason. It's our future that's at stake here, and that's why I'm so thankful for guys like you who do all the work that you do and the hard work. People go to your site and they get the information, and even if they don't believe it all, they pick up enough pieces to where when the next thing comes in front of them, then they're back again. They're back again looking at it again. Like, for instance, I have a lot of folks that have stocked food, but they are anti-gun completely. And they completely reject the scenario that they may need one to keep what's theirs. And so I often talk about the mindset of some of the inner city gangs and things like that. I've actually spoken to a couple of guys that were pretty high up in Sereno S-13 gang, and they said basically to me this: if you're not strong enough to keep it, it wasn't yours in the first place. And is that generally the mindset that you've seen from folks that basically don't care about the American way of life or have no regard for society in general?
Well, unfortunately, we live in a society where people have developed both an entitlement mentality and the opinion that the police department and fire department will be there instantly to protect them and their property. And I think it, neither of those are realistic mentalities. And I think that the next major catastrophe that our country sees, if it is, you know, a truly coast-to-coast kind of catastrophe, we'll probably bring that to an end. We'll go back to the old, you know, more traditional mentality, which is that, you know, every family needs to provide for themselves, and that includes not just feeding your family, but also defending your family. And I think it's very likely that a lot of the people that are anti-gun right now will suddenly have a change of heart when we see what happened in the wake of the L.A. riots in 1992, where you had suburbanites rushing to gun shops and then disappointed to find that that the liberal politicians that they had voted for had also mandated a 7-day waiting period to buy a gun in California. they kind of got a dose of their own medicine there, and they realized it's just how foolish they had been. People who had never wanted a gun before suddenly saw the need for one. And I would suspect that a very similar situation is going to come up, but on a grand scale. And any extra firearms that you have, and things like extra magazines, extra ammunition, extra holsters, are going to be very valuable commodities for barter. And one of the most important things that you can dispense in charity for your relatives and friends and neighbors, because they may not have silver and gold coins to pay you with. All they may have is dollars that are worthless to hand to you. But at least you'll be able to put a gun in the hand of you know, two or three of your friends, so they can defend their families and say, well, okay, it's not a great gun, but it's a gun, and it's yours, and here's 100 rounds of ammunition for it. I wish you the best of luck. You should have listened to me before, but that's about the best you can expect. You know, you're not going to be able to hand out a top-of-the-line battle rifle and 1,000 rounds of ammunition to umpteen friends. That's just not realistic. But a lot of your older guns, you know, old military surplus bolt-action Mausers or Enfields, that sort of thing, or a Mosin-Nagant, are just ideal to hand out to people. And for people that are not very familiar with guns, a bolt action is probably the ideal thing to give them anyway, because if you hand them a semi-automatic, they might get into spray and pray mode and waste a lot of ammunition.
Amen. Amen. I agree with that philosophy. And we've got about 10 minutes left, MCAD, so I want to give you a couple of questions in a row, and then I've got about one more for him as well. So go ahead and take the floor.
All right. Well, a lot of people have mentioned that they don't have enough money to prepare for this, and, you know, people can't prepare as well as the people did in the book Patriots. And what I try to tell them is that preparation isn't about being perfect. It's about using what you have. It's about doing the best you can with what you have. And as long
exactly.
as you prepare, you'll be better off. You'll be better off than you would be if you did absolutely nothing. You know, I mean, my preparation
right.
is far from perfect. But does that mean I'm going to sit on my butt? No, it's ridiculous. So you just got to do the best that you can. So my question is, and I'm not expecting you to endorse any of this because it's just a crazy idea that I have in my head. I cannot get a hold of antibiotics. I've been thinking about animal antibiotics. I've been thinking
yep,
about that.
Yes, veterinary antibiotics in a pinch. Yes. Like even the ones made for aquarium hobbyists work just fine. And a lot of them come out of the same batches of penicillin or amoxicillin that are made for human use. They're just labeled differently. I do not recommend using them in the current present day, but in terms of a good stockpile to set aside that you leave in your refrigerator, they're very inexpensive, so when you go to rotate them once every 2 or 3 years, it's not a huge expense to toss out the old and replace them. Whereas if you're buying full FDA-approved, USP grade pharmaceuticals, it's very expensive to replace them. So pick up a 2-pound tub of tetracycline, for example, and replace it once every 2 years. Leave it in the back of your fridge. You could treat thousands of people with one 2-pound tub. I mean, in terms of human doses, it's hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of doses in one 2-pound tub. But you can buy that at a feed store for about $20. The equivalent
what is that
in
called?
Human doses. I'm sorry. The tetracycline.
What is it called? What was the name of that? Okay.
Tetracycline. And if you want to be ready for a plague, there's your ammunition right there. And again, it's cheap enough that you can throw it away once every 2 years. So you don't have to worry about using things past their expiration date. And tetracycline, by the way, is one of the ones that you really have to worry about using past its expiration date.
We did get a caller, but it sounds like they've got their speakers turned up, so I'm going to have to cut them from the feed. I just wanted to let you know that was the little bit of feedback we were getting.
All right. Oh, that's all right.
Caller, call back in when you've got your speakers turned down. And anybody else as well, one of the things that happens if you call in with your speakers turned up, you just backfeed into the stream. We can't hear you and you can't hear us. So please make sure that you mute your speakers before you call in. Go ahead. Please continue, Mr. Walls.
Anyway, I was going to say veterinary pharmaceuticals are a great way to stock up relatively inexpensively, and, of course, there's no prescription required.
All right. That was going to be one of the questions that I was going to ask you was about fish antibiotics. I'd heard about the horse antibiotics and those things. Somebody had sent me some links to fish antibiotics, and I've actually purchased some.
I covered that in my blog just recently, just a couple of weeks back. If you just search under veterinary and antibiotic in the search box, that's at the top of the right-hand bar at survivalblog.com, that post will come up, and it has detailed information with links.
All right. And lastly, we've got 6 minutes to go before I have to take us out to break. And, of course, I know we only had you for an hour tonight. So my last question, of course, is about you talked about the Mosin Nagant. And so a lot of folks I know have 44 Magnum and 30-06 because they're pretty common calibers, per se, that a lot of people own them around the country, but not necessarily used by the military. Is it your position that folks should really get a weapon in 5.56 or 7.62?
Well, it's not crucial. What's crucial is the amount of ammunition that you store. You could actually have a firearm in an oddball caliber. Say your favorite deer hunting cartridge was .243 Winchester. I wouldn't want to get shot with a .243 Winchester at 300 yards. It's a wonderful flat shooting cartridge. If you store 3,000 rounds of .243, more power to you if you're really good with that rifle. The man behind the rifle is more important than the caliber. In terms of standardization for a really long-term situation, yes, I would stick with standard calibers. And in terms of standardization within a group or a neighborhood, then standardization is very important. But if you're on your own, the caliber isn't all that important. What's important is the depth of your stack of ammo cans.
I agree. And
now, 5.56 NATO is, I consider, an underpowered cartridge for most. It's not even legal to hunt deer with in a lot of states. And, deer weigh less than men in most situations, so most country, other than mule deer. So I think it's important that if you're going to buy a modern military caliber, that you make it 7.62 NATO, or at least the 7.62x39, which is the Russian cartridge that was made for the SKS and the AK-47. And it's quite a bit less powerful than 308, but at least it has better ballistics, to my mind, than 5.56. People argue these kind of things endlessly, but as far as I'm concerned, bore diameter trumps velocity. And basically practice with and carry and shoot the most powerful gun that you can shoot accurately, rapidly. And for the average full-size adult male, that's usually .308 Winchester or 7.62 NATO. Unless you are like 5 foot nothing and weigh 110 pounds dripping wet, there's no need, you know, to go as small as 5.56 NATO. You can handle 7.62 NATO or .308 Winchester. It's even my late wife, who weighed, 105 pounds and was 5 foot two, she hunted with a .308 and she didn't have any problem with it whatsoever. So when I see guys that are 5'9 and weigh 150 saying .308 is too much for them, I have to wonder.
Hello? Hello?
Yes, are you on?
Yes, you're on with you're on with James Wesley Rawls and Doc on the Watchman.fm. Go ahead, state your name and your question.
Okay, my name is Jane, and I'm buying a generator. Now, the generator runs on natural gas or LP, but in case of a, a shit-hit-the-fan scenario, what would happen with the natural gas? Would it, you know,
well, if it's if it's piped natural gas from a utility, it will probably carry on for several months if you are in a wellhead area. But up until the last 5 years or so, when a lot of the utilities started switching over to natural gas-fired compressor stations, most of the compressor stations for natural gas pipelines use grid power. So if the grid goes down, chances are you're going to lose that piped natural gas. And if you can, when you buy a generator, it's best to buy what's called a tri-fuel generator, which will run on piped natural gas or propane or gasoline with a tri-fuel generator. And you could, if your local zoning will allow it, you can also, even if you're on piped a utility natural gas, you can also install a propane tank right in your yard, even in a suburban place. Put it in your backyard and build a nice decorative planter around it or something so people don't ask you too many questions about it. But you could have a large propane tank, and typically the restrictions that are placed on gasoline tanks in suburban and urban areas don't apply to propane tanks. Typically you can get away with having a 500-gallon tank. You have to check your local ordinances, but that's what I would recommend.
And we are down to just 2 minutes left, and so I am going to have to let you go, caller. I appreciate you calling in. Call back anytime. I have to give Mr. Rawls a chance to say good evening to the audience and Dimcat as well. So you have a wonderful night.
All right, thank you. Bye.
Okay.
Thanks for your call.
Yeah. Okay, Dimcat. I know that you got dropped a couple times there. I want to give you a chance to finish up. I don't mind going into a little bit into the second hour so that you guys can finish up. I want to make sure that Mr. Rawls also has a chance to give out the pertinent websites that he'd like to give out as well. So if you have one more question for him, go ahead, and then we'll let him say good evening to the audience and let folks know where to find his site and his book and any other information.
I just wanted to mention the survivalblog.com. There's a section for newbies, and he talks about the list of lists. So I just recommend, if you haven't really gotten into preparation, that you guys get into that. He might want to comment on that. And again, thank you for
mentioning that. That's one of the free resources that's available at the blog. It's specifically designed for people to get started in preparedness. If you go to the Survival Blog website, and you look in the left-hand bar, you'll see a column of buttons, and one of them is titled Getting Started. If you click on that, it'll bring you up to a quick start guide for newbies. And that includes the often mentioned list of lists that I have on the website. It's also included in my book, How to Survive the End of the World as We Know It. But it's all available free, again, at survivalblog.com. My only proviso is don't start reading my blog at 10 o'clock at night, or you'll be up until 2 or 3 in the morning. And And if you have any questions for me, please use the search box at the blog site. That's in the right-hand column, to search for archived articles. There's thousands and thousands of archived articles on all sorts of topics related to preparedness. I get the same kind of questions day after day after day about things that are already included in the blog. So try to use the search box first before you email me.
All right, Mr. Rawls, it's been a pleasure having you on. I hope to have you back again soon. It's always a pleasure having you on, DIMCAD. So, and our audience has really turned, I mean, just poured out for you. So I want to thank the audience for coming out, and you have a wonderful night, Mr. Rawls.
All right, thank you, and God bless.
God bless you, too. Wow, DIMCAD, that was a fantastic guest right there, man. Why don't you go ahead and give folks out your websites again, and anything that you didn't get to say to folks, go on ahead and say your good evenings and your go-hears to them, and I can't wait to have you back again as well, my friend.
All right, it's been a pleasure. I want to make this really short. You can find me on YouTube, youtube.com/DIMCAD, D-E-M-C-A-D. When it comes to preparing, I'm going to leave you guys with a quote. It is, "The future belongs to those who prepare for it today." So please get preparing.
All right, my friend. You have a wonderful night, and we'll do this again real soon.
All right.